Thank you for that. And good morning to everyone. I'm glad to be here on this second day. And in the coming half an hour, I'm going to tell you more about social media for the brand Visit Holland. I've been working in that role for 3 years now, so let's get started. What I'm going to tell you today is information that's really behind the scenes. When I see a presentation that I like, a speaker that's really motivating me to listen even better to what he's saying about his or her amazing campaigns, I'm always wondering, what kind of budget do they have to make this happen? And how can I get the best learnings out of this and do something with it with the budget that I am having? So let me start with that. 85K, that is what I have on a yearly basis to spend on social media activities for tourists across the whole world to promote Holland, to attract them to visit Holland. For this amount, I do everything. I'm building communities, I'm managing the communities, I manage a little group of freelancers who help me moderate those channels. I run campaigns with this money. And it's only fair to say that everything is included, everything you can imagine, except the salary for myself. Just to be transparent, like I would like other speakers to be as well. I can imagine that looking at you all, that some will have a bigger budget to spend for social media on a yearly basis, but also there will be people who have less money to spend. And I will guarantee you that during this presentation, I'm going to give you actual takeaways for any budget to promote or to implement for you tomorrow, if you would like. What I did 3 years ago, I built a strategy. Because when I started there, there was no one before me in the specific role of social media manager. So I had a whole bunch of social media channels with different qualities, with different targets or target groups or goals, and with different amount of communities. So when I started this strategy, I went for an engagement strategy. Because I think, and I think a lot of people would agree, engagement is key. Of course, I've written this strategy 3 years ago, and a lot has been changing around in social media during the past 3 years, but still, engagement is key for me. That doesn't mean that my strategy is completely and only based on engagement. Because I believe and I strive for three pillars within my strategy. That's value, engagement, and growth. I don't see if someone comes up to me and asks, how does one of your Facebook pages performs? I would say I have 1 million likes. That says nothing about the way it performs. If I would say my engagement is 16% on this Facebook page in a specific time frame, that doesn't say something. It says something if you can tell someone something about value, the engagement, and the growth. By the way, you will hear me say Facebook a lot during this presentation, because for us, Facebook isn't dead. It's the way to attract visitors to Holland, because our target group is really on Facebook. But whenever you hear me say Facebook, you can easily just see other social media channels in that as well. So, when I was building the strategy, I of course looked at different websites to give me the information I needed. So I looked at Social Bakers and Skift.com, which are really great websites, by the way. And I was always confused about the way they were presenting lists of how brands perform on social media. Because in my opinion, they do focus a lot on how many likes a Facebook page has. And we all know, what does that say? It doesn't say that much. So what I do is I take it all together. Engagement, growth, and value. I want to focus a little bit more on value, because what did I do to give me a metrics to define value for Facebook? I looked and looked and find the SEAF, Social Equivalent Advertising Value, also called SAVE. How did I come up with this one? Well, I didn't by myself. I looked it up, and it is Tourism Ireland who came up with this metric. And why did they do this? Simply because of the reason that there wasn't any metric that gave us some kind of insights about advertising value for social media. Which is kind of weird that it wasn't already there, because if you look at PR activities, it's really normal to say something about what the advertising value is. So Tourism Ireland did this because of there was a lack of the fact that a lack of this metric. And what they did is they looked at the different kinds of engagement you have on Facebook, and they give it a weight. So every kind of engagement had a certain value in money. They come up with this algorithm that you can see right there. And with this algorithm, they calculate a certain value for your Facebook page. So when someone comes up to me and asks me, how does your Facebook page perform? Or internally, someone wants to know the results of my Facebook pages. This is what I say. With 260,000 likes, an engagement percentage of 16, and an advertising value of 45K in the month August 2014, we did a pretty good job. This is the core of my strategy for social media. This is what really says something. And the best thing would be if I could add the following to this sentence. And above this all, I had X amount of bookings coming via organic communication on social media, on Facebook. On Facebook, unfortunately, don't bet on it. If you want to have bookings for us, it doesn't work organically. But what does work, and it's quite interesting to notice, is that Pinterest is working for us for bookings. And not Amsterdam, the pinboard Amsterdam. It's really nice, but it doesn't really work for us. If you look at bookings, you have beach, you have holiday homes in Zeeland, or anything that you know from research that is really attractive for international tourists to come to Holland for. But what do they book on? Castles in Holland. If you think of Holland, and I'm living in it, I wouldn't directly think of castles. But it does work, so it's something I'm going to investigate a little bit more. So far, what I did with executing or building a strategy. But back to the good stuff. How do I execute it? How do I make sure that only me in this role is communicating and promoting Holland all through the whole world, with different social media channels in many different languages? And this is what I do. I have a secret. And it's my holy grail. It's the best part of my job. Without this, it wouldn't be as much fun as it is right now. Because I have a team. I recruited the Holland Ambassadors team. You see, 7 people here that working as so-called Holland Ambassadors. And with this team, I made the perfect combination between expertise, knowledge about social media, but also culture and languages all across the world. Because if you look, for instance, at Stefano Stanic, he was born and raised in Italy. He lived a greater part of his mature life in Italy, but now he lives in Holland. Not for a little while, but to stay here. So before I even recruited him, he is the perfect Holland ambassador, because he actually took the initiative to go to Holland himself. We just were, or not all of us, but I am. I was just born in this country. That doesn't make me an ambassador. So, and the fact is that all those Holland ambassadors have social media knowledge. Some of them have a blog about Holland. Some of them have an extensive network in their home country or in the Netherlands. So by combining their expertise and mine, I have the perfect combination to moderate all social media channels. So that's who they are. But what do they do? Every workday, they work between 1.5 or at the max 1 hour a day as Holland Ambassador. They do have other jobs. They don't work solely for me. They do not work in weekends or in the evenings. And the fun thing is that you hear a lot of people saying, well, how do you do that? Because social media is 24/7. Yes, it may be for service desk-oriented organizations, such as KLM, for instance. But I'm not such an organization. I'm part of an organization that is marketing-based. It's there for creating awareness on social media, apart amongst other things. So I have never, in those 3 years that I'm working as Holland social media manager, have any complaint whatsoever on any social media saying, why didn't you answer my question in the evenings? Why didn't you say something on Saturday because I already asked the questions on Friday? I've never ever had that before. Of course, one of you can now go to one of the social media channels, give me that complaint, and I can never say this in any other presentations in the future. So my communication with the Holland ambassadors is mainly online because they work at home. 2 times a year I try to organize a lunch and we are all together. And to give you the feeling that I want them to have and that I think I managed to get is that they're really part of the digital marketing team. You see a web page, a landing page from holland.com, the About Us part, and there you see them back in the part where you see the employees. So they're really a part of the team. So, okay, I've got a social media team in place. I know what I'm going for. I know how to measure it. And what happens? What happens on a day-to-day basis? Because I do know the difference between cultures, and if I don't know them, the Holland ambassadors do, so we have that combined knowledge. But still, it's funny to show you, or interesting to let you see, what is happening on a day-to-day basis? What kind of examples can I give you that we've been dealing with during the past 3 years? Because there are a lot of differences that you can't really do something on forehand. Sometimes it just happens and then you have to act on it. And how do we do it? How do we engage? How do we interact? How do we proactive community management? What does it really mean for me, for us? Let me start by what makes my job real fun, because I am all about the strategy part, but also I'm just working on the community itself. So I do every level, which makes it a really good job. But what happens if you look at that lower part, the part that really interacts with the community, you see that people think that we are a travel agency. So more than once, we get the question, like Niref is asking us, hi, I'm going to Holland on that and that period, in that and that time frame. Can you please help me? Oh, sure we can. This is our website. And if you have specific questions, we can direct you to specific landing pages. Have a great trip to Holland. And then he says, oh, by the way, can you please organize my whole trip? So that's what happened. And that not only once. People really think, maybe that's a positive thing, that there's someone behind the page. So it's personal. They feel like they can ask something. But what they're asking is sometimes completely weird. And one of the examples that I wanted to show you as well is that this Keith person that you see on the other slide, I think he was drunk or something was not right because he was asking us, hello, I've got this number. Do you know to whom it belongs in the Netherlands? And we are saying, because it's a direct or a personal message in Facebook, so we do react at least once, even though it's not tourist-related, we do react. And then we say, I'm sorry, we don't have that for you, so we can't help you with this. Oh, how about this number, or that number, or that number, or that number, or that number? So he keeps, and this is just short part of what is happening with this Keith person. It makes it fun, because sometimes when you're on social media, the negative comments, which are there, and it's fine that they're there, and we don't delete them, because it's a community, you can say whatever you want, within limits as racism or abusive things. But it's fun if you have a little bit of a negative flow going on certain channels sometimes. And then you have this, it makes you laugh. It makes you go like, okay, this is the reality as well. What happens a lot as well is, for some reason, Holland is also known for nice men and women. They know how to find us. So what happens, mainly on the French and on the US Facebook page is, hello, please, can you help me? I'm a man and I'm really sophisticated. I'm looking for a woman. She must be blonde and blue eyes. Thank you. Or, this is really fun. This is a guy on the photo, but it's actually a girl who wants to meet him or wants to find him, really. Because what happened, she went in Turkey on a holiday and she emailed this to us, or via personal message, and saying, I don't know his name, I don't know where he lives, I don't know what his age is, I do know he's from Holland, and he has a tattoo on his back. Please find him for me. So these kinds of messages really make it fun. Back to the humor and the culture thing. We had the World Cup last year. And as you may all know, or at least the Dutch will definitely know, and the Spanish persons, because Van Robben had a penalty taken, which wasn't really a penalty, that thing. And the Spanish page got nuts over this. My Holland ambassador, Lorena, who spends around an average of 5 hours a week to moderate, had to spend in that two-week time frame twice as much hours sitting behind the desk, deleting, hiding, blocking people, saying the most abusive, racist things you can imagine. I know no era penal for the rest of my life. That means no penalty. That's something I cannot forget anymore. It's somehow maybe also normal that the Spanish page reacted this way, because we played the football against a lot of Spanish-speaking countries. So you could imagine, okay, maybe then there's a lot of anger against us because we won a lot. But it was even before this penalty that the Spanish people are harsh. They are all over the page and not in a positive way. So what we did during this World Cup that we really wanted to go along with, because it was something that we could just have on our page, and it was there, it was famous, everyone was talking about it, so why wouldn't we just get it in our community? But we stopped for the Spanish page, because it was not overweighing the positive comments or the negative comments that could stay on the page. And on the other hand, if you look at the Brazilian page or the American page, they were lovely. They were all dressed in orange, and the dog was wearing an orange crown, and photos came coming on the page all the time. So you see that this difference between those countries are really, really a lot of differences. It's not just that you think, okay, I went to Spain sometime, so I know a little bit of their culture, and I know they drink cerveza and they have tapas. That's just not enough. And of course, we all know that, but this is a good example of what is happening on your pages, and that you really, if you have a group like I have called the Holland Ambassadors, or you have it organized some other way, but you have those people who know the culture, who knows what is funny, how do you speak to people? It really is so important. Boycott Holland. We have this guy. He has been with us on Twitter for 3 years. He's Dutch, which is really important. I'll tell you in a little while. And he finds it his hobby to tell us that the Netherlands and Holland aren't the same thing. I know it's not the same thing. But our brand is called Holland. Why are we calling the brand Holland? Why are we communicating Holland? Because in research, it shows that abroad, people know Holland much better than they know what the Netherlands is. And we are here, not for the Dutch, we are here for the people abroad. But what happened is he just kept on saying, oh, this is not Holland, this is the Netherlands. And we explained it once to him. And then he said another tweet and he used hashtag let's go, hashtag boycott Holland. And what we did then is we took it offline. What I did is I sent him a DM three times saying, hello, could you visit us in the office? I am very glad to tell you more about the fact why we are calling it Holland and not the Netherlands. He refused, but he kept on going. Again, the thing is that about this difference between Holland and the Netherlands, the only one in 3 years' time who complain about this are the Dutch people, or the Dutch people who immigrated to the US, for instance. But never ever, again, you can do something about this right now, have ever complained about it and not being Dutch. Okay, this is going to make me vulnerable, because this is a big mistake I've made. You have Rokjesdag, Skirts Day. And that means in Holland, when it's the first day of the year that it's really sunny and warm, women are wearing skirts. And it's fun. It's something that is commonly known. And we thought it would be really good to say something about this on social media, because it's not something you find in the Lonely Planet or on our website. It's a hidden gem, and we know that our communities really love those kinds of facts. So I wrote a post saying something about those skirts. And the Brazilian, the Italian, and the US came back to me separately, starting with the Italian saying, hi Tessa, I really can't post this because two out of three men in Italy are somewhere in their lives being accused of abusing women. If I post this, it's not going to get well received. So I said to him, okay, and even if you wrap it up in another way, we tried everything, saying it like a fact and not with a call to action, or try different things, and you just kept saying, no, it's not going to work, I'd rather not post it. And then I go along with him. I say, okay, if this is what you think, I go with you, because you are the one who knows about the Italian culture. Brazil as well, and the US as well, so we didn't post this one for those countries. On the other hand, if you look at Germany, Belgium, Russia, they loved it. The Russian Holland ambassador said, no, please, can we post it twice? Because people are really glad that they can finally get out of their winter clothes and their scarves and everything. So again, something so flat, something of which you think, okay, this can only be nice, isn't well received in every country. And tulips. As you've seen during my presentation, you see wooden clocks, you see windmills, and Holland has lots more to offer than just that. But it comes down to the fact that if your community, for instance, is not working really well, and you want an engaging post, I put a tulip in, because it always works. A windmill, it just works. And who am I to say, okay, you must not like windmills and tulips, but look at Marshall Wonders, or look at, I don't know, only Giethoorn. So it's almost tulip time, they're almost blooming. And I came up with a post, go to the fields and smell the tulips. Tulips do not really have a scent. After 3 years and living my whole life in Holland, I should have known this. So all pages were full of, this is not true, this is not true. So that's my fault. So I keep on learning as well. Only one slide after this one. What I wanted to tell you is a wrap-up. What did I learn during those years? What I'm doing differently than I did before in the beginning, 3 years ago. already in my introduction, I keep repeating it, is go for the long haul. It's nothing new. I've heard it from presentations last year on this stage in Finland as well. Don't run from campaign to campaign. I don't have the budget to do so. I need to do something that has a long-term effect. So I don't say don't do any campaigns. I'm not saying that. But if you do a campaign, make sure you can use whatever you are doing in that campaign. For instance, we had a photo contest asking people to send in their photos. And what we're doing now is we're posting those photos in the community with credits, the whole shebang, everything like you normally would with the good credits. And people love it. People are sharing it. And we like it because we can use it after the campaign ended. Not so sexy, but really important is an organized workflow. I'm a big fan of Google Drive. I have extended Excel sheets with content plannings, and they are all planned a month ahead. That does not mean I have the flexibility to change posts during a month, but it does give me sort of a lower risk in how the communication goes on when there's a Holland ambassador sick or a plane crash happens. I can immediately know, I know what to do because I have a crisis document. So I have certain communication already there. So I don't have the Russian Holland ambassador at my side every time, but I do have her knowledge, her already translated sentences for specific events. So get that workflow organized. Stick to your strategy. I talked to Cheryl just before my presentation. I was smiling because I think he agrees with me. If you look at the social media landscape, it's changing rapidly. And every day there are new social media channels popping up. And you have the urge sometimes, or I do, or the feeling that you really have to do something with everything. Or at least with some of them every day. But you don't. You just look at what's coming up and you see, okay, does this help with my strategy? Because my strategy still stands. That's what I'm going for. And if Snapchat is the way to go, because my strategy really, the channel really helps with my strategy, I will do it. But if not, don't do it. Look every day. Is what I'm doing the right thing? But if the answer is yes, keep on doing what you're doing. Don't change it. And last but not least is let communities tell your story. Curating. It's nothing new, but it's still there, and it's really, really popular still. Again, the example is the photo contest. Lots of people are sharing their photos. It's a great way to get really good content from people who actually been to Holland and are in a wooden shoe with fingers like this and, you know, in the tulip fields and everything. Not that exciting, you would think, because every photo is almost the same. But they love to share it. And people in our communities love to see real photos, not the photoshopped ones, not the ones made from a photographer, but just me standing in front of the Magere Brug in Amsterdam, for instance. And if you think, okay, my community is a little bit stiffer and doesn't really go and interact with us a lot, give them an incentive, make it a game. Say, okay, if you share with us your beautiful Holland photos at the end of the game, we randomly pick 10 winners and you have a prize. And that prize does not have to be a plane ticket, a five-star restaurant and hotel and, I don't know, more expensive things. For us, it was a cup and a dish. And lots of people like it. So at the one hand, I concluded, okay, it doesn't really matter. They just like to share it. And on the other hand, as long as there is a prize, people are willing to play along with you. So those are my four lessons learned that I really wanted to get across today. And I didn't talk a lot about what we're going to do in the future, but I'm going to do it now. This year, and I saw, unfortunately I wasn't here yesterday, but I saw on the Twitter stream that video is key in 2015. amongst other things, but we think as well. So what we did is I developed, together with a company, 10 little movies to discover Holland, to experience Holland, really. And what we did is that we made this really short videos. We didn't put them live yet, but I'm going to give you a sneak peek in a minute. Those videos are 30 seconds long, no longer. And MHC Holland Marketing is really focusing on spreading in time and space. So don't come to Holland only for the big cities on a sunny day, but do so on a windy day in November on the beach. So this is the beach I wanted to show you. This is especially for the German and the Belgian market. Thank you very much.